is like. Little change of heart, change of heart. Forget this fear and frustration.
That's Whitney. Yeah, looking good on the video.
Yes, she was. The Whitney we know. Hello, I'm Natasha Harrison, President and CEO of CommunityBuild Ventures.
And I'm Ayodele Harrison, Senior Partner of CommunityBuild Ventures and also Director of BME's Talk.
Right there. Yes, and so I have been doing some daily conversations around what I'm learning from COVID-19. And thought today, since we're talking about education as the topic, to bring in you, Ayodele.
Thank you.
To share your perspective and thoughts
so
around.
So I can rant and rave, so I can just get loud.
About education as a parent or as an educator, which one?
I mean, I could take all hats. I mean, okay. As a parent, as an educator, as a consultant in this work, as a concerned community person. I mean, there's a lot of different things to be thinking about.
Sure. So as I always start off with is just sharing a little bit about CommunityBuild Ventures in regards to who we are. So I'm going to officially start the presentation that I'm sharing. And again, I have been having conversations since Tuesday, April 7th, around what I'm learning from COVID-19. A little bit about CommunityBuild Ventures. We work to eliminate, committed to eliminating racial disparities by developing powerful, impactful, racial equity-driven leaders and organizations. And we promise to help people and organizations learn and practice in brave space, center racial equity, and heal through the process. And how we do that is through three service areas. We do what we call Thrive Design, which is racial equity design impact analysis and strategic planning work that centers racial equity. We also do learn and practice, which is we provide experiential learning opportunities. And then the last service that actually we weave through anything that we're engaged with, but we also provide healing and emotional self-care services and or learn and practice opportunities. Most of our work in this area really centers healing justice to think about how do we heal Blackness in our world, the experience of Black people, people from the African diaspora in our world, and what does that look like within an organization and within ourselves. So that's CommunityBuild Ventures. Anything else I should add?
I think about? Now.
Okay.
Like you always do.
All right. And again, if you've been viewing the videos and tuning in, we always like to start with brave space building. For CommunityBuild Ventures, it's a six-step process. And so today, I really, since I have someone here with me, is to really explore, one of the things that we do is really explore feelings, talk about gratitude and intentions. And we do this, brave space building is designed to help individuals, organizations, institutions to really show up as their authentic self and to really be brave and stay within a conversation that centers racial equity. And so I will model and pass it over to you, Ayodele. So I am feeling rested, excited. We just signed on a new partner for some work that we're really excited to be partnering with here in Georgia. I am feeling determined, very determined, but I'm also very concerned again about the effects of COVID-19 in particularly Black communities, but then also seeing a lot of friends and family being personally affected by it. And so I am grateful for the weather. We got an opportunity to walk out today. I am grateful for having a safe and stable home. I'm very grateful that I'm able to work from home. I'm also very grateful for the wonderful people that I get to work with every day and connect with. My intentions for today is to be curious during the conversation around education. And I am complete.
Hey, so Ayodele here. I'm feeling calm, feeling rested. I've really been taking the time to slow down and understand that there's no way that I can complete a full work day anymore, just with all the new responsibilities in the home. Not that I've been negligent with responsibilities, but it's like just with more with learn, you know, distant learning, those types of things. I just realized that just the timing is different. And so with that, I've really been focused on slowing down. And so that has helped me put me in a place of feeling very calm, you know, as we navigate our current challenges that we all face. Grateful. Let me see here. A lot to be grateful. I'm grateful for another healthy breath. You know, I'm grateful for I'm grateful for time to be spent with the family. You know, I think it's with, you know, our daily work of commuting and all those types of things, we miss out on times. And I think we've made dinner in some way, shape, or form, I think probably over the last 2 weeks, 12 times. She always got to remind me, like three weeks, what is that? That's 21 days. So at least 18 days.
We only ate out twice.
Yeah. And that's, you know, purchasing food.
We didn't 19 days.
19 days, you know, for us prepping and that's huge.
And breakfast, lunch, and dinner.
Right.
So that's, right. Yeah.
So I'm grateful for that. You know, it's so much I want to acknowledge how much time has been gained in this time of being in the home. Intentions, you know, quite honestly, it's just, Natasha took it as like to be curious, but really just to share some thinking. And I've been talking to the wall quite a bit and a few folks on the phone call on what I think, you know, this impact COVID-19 will have on education as we move forward, just finishing this school year through the summer and into the next year. Just some thoughts. So I just want to be, my intention is just to share some honest thoughts and thinking and questions that I have around, I guess what people say is the restart, whenever that might come. I am complete.
All right. Please share in the comment box, how you're feeling, what you're grateful for at this moment, and what are your intentions, whether that is, what you hope to learn from our discussion today, very centered around education, or just your intentions general for the day, and what, you know, even what you hope to accomplish today. And again, in the comment box, please share your feelings, gratitude, and intentions. All right. So I shared this meme that I found actually through my personal Facebook feed that I thought was like spot on. Even our conversations with a cousin of ours who has 3 children and trying to navigate. And so Sean Peck basically says, have you ever taken an online class? How about 6 at once when you were a teenager with spotty Wi-Fi and Schoology crashing and needed to share a device with siblings? While trapped at home, filled with fear and anxiety, yeah, me neither. Let's cut these kids some slack. Mm-hmm. So definitely, this week is spring break for our kids. Oh, and by the way, if you didn't catch, we are married. We didn't, all these pictures behind us. In our home, just want to recognize that. But since the second week of March, right? All these pictures behind us. Since the second week of March, right? March. Mm-hmm. Basically, we've been trying to figure out, and I'm trying to figure out the right term It's not homeschooling, because to me that's an intentional choice of parents saying that they, right? Is it online learning? Whatever it is. Again, what I really like about this particular meme that I saw that became a meme, right, or conversation piece, is the fact that when he said this, right, this filled with fear and anxiety, like we're having a traumatic experience, nothing that we even planned for. Our children, the parents, we didn't plan for this, and we are not educators. Luckily, I have an educator in my home, which we definitely have a privilege of, like,
well, if I can push back, okay. I think, well, one thing that's important, and just to continue, is like we as parents are our children's first educator, or as caregivers, as care providers, yes, and things like that. And so we have, yes, to expand the what we think of education, right? Now, if we talk about professionals that are in the educational system, public school, private school, whatever that might be, that's a little bit different. I don't know what you would call that. I don't know, but I yes, don't want to take the term educator away, because it's not an assumption that our kids go to school with nothing, right? Like they've gained a lot of, yes, strategies, tools, okay, and ways to, right, navigate, values that they come with. Someone had to teach them that, and it was parents, caregivers, community, right, whatever that might be, and that's a form of education.
Right? Yes. I guess the right term I'm saying is that I am not an expert of having a class, thinking about our five-year-old, a class of like 10, 12 kids. Mm-hmm. And with the energy, honestly, that our kindergarten teachers have, and how they connect with these five-year-olds, and they're writing about how to do something.
Right.
Right. I'm not savvy. I know that I don't have those skills of like, how did you do that? Like, I'm like, wow. Right. Right? Like I just don't. But which means that I need to learn very quickly in a traumatic experience to help my daughter.
Well, I think it's
like,
so
figure, yeah, that out. But what I want to say is, all in all, with this is that the expectations that we are trying to take what the school environment is like and culture, and then say every household has to recreate that, is what I feel. What I've been seeing other parents that are in my community, whether that's social community, Facebook particularly, that I've been seeing and having conversations back and forth with other parents and friends, is that like this need, you know, like there's this, I feel the pressure and the expectation that Sean is expressing while having fear and anxiety, and thinking about the pandemic, like, you know, I don't know if that is a reasonable expectation. Same thing goes for work, right? When you said, hey, I'm have to think about a pace that my full day is no longer anymore.
Yeah. And I think, well, so with your audience, we're reaching folks all over the globe, but all over the country, and every city, state, school district within these states operates a little bit differently, right? And so we not everybody has been given the mandate to make sure you fully recreate this, right? I think what's happening is schools would like there to be some normality of learning to continue to happen, like to be able to stay, keep teachers connected to their students and in that sort of way. So I think there's a range of expectations that I think are being delivered, you know, in terms of, you know, whether this work will count, whether this is just keeping you engaged and things like that. So it's pretty broad in that sense of where exactly school districts are at with that. I think there is a lot of language around, we strongly encourage that you follow this, you know, and a pattern or engage in this as best as possible. But what I've shared with my wife and with others, it just for parents, you know, you're doing the best that you can. There's a lot that's mm-hmm. happening in this time, right? And so, and we also have to give ourselves, we have to be self-compassionate in this space, because it's not online learning, right? Because it's not something that we signed. I mean, we're learning online, but it's not online learning or homeschooling. We're schooling, stream of consciousness. We are schooling at home, or at, some people even say, are we trying to recreate the schooling experience mm-hmm. at home, mm-hmm. right? And I've been in community yeah. discussions where we've mm-hmm. talked about the difference between schooling and education, right? And I think really I want to take this time to focus on this actually, for not for all, I mean, and it's hard, but it's focusing on trying to provide an educational experience for our children. I know that's what we try and provide, right, as best as we can. And yeah, you know, each home is completely different. But I think trying to do schooling online, right, or schooling at home is a challenge and is very difficult. And you're going to try and do the best you can. But I would honestly say, like, to say that you are doing the very best that you can, because we have some households that parents are working full time, mm-hmm. right, and have to walk away and leave children. I was latchkey when, you know, for those who aren't familiar, that's where the child comes home and lets themselves in or goes to school on their own just because of working situations. My mother was a K-5 educator for 16 years, and I was a latchkey kid. So it's like I didn't go to the same school that she worked at. So I would come home and be responsible for getting my work done, especially in middle school. But in elementary school, I would go to a daycare space. So, I mean, the key is to try and continue learning that happens with there, but then also be compassionate with yourself. We've had an experience where, you know, we've split the duties of trying to cover the best mm-hmm. we can the material that's been sent home. But there's some days that we tell our child to watch cartoons on Netflix, you know, because we're trying to keep other things, you know, going. We still have full-time jobs that we're still trying to work and do that. So I send you great thank you and appreciation, parents, guardians, caregivers, community members, for doing the best that you can. And to know this, right, these months that we have are critical for learning, but a lot of that learning can take place through the relationships that we build with them. And I would say that this is why some school districts are really pushing to get kids connected, is because of those relationships that are established in their building. How do we keep them going? Mm-hmm. You know, in that way. So
yeah, exactly. And so I want to definitely continue our conversation, but really focus on what schools, school districts, school systems, charter management organizations, even independent and private schools, right? It's like all of the above, right? Because it's mm-hmm. just like what you just said, like it affects all of us. Some, we'll talk more about some more than others. But wanted to share that Iodale leads our Equity Center School Improvement Services. A lot of our work is really, really around how do we help support closing the academic performance and opportunity gaps by creating equitable school classroom learning environments, especially for our most vulnerable, marginalized students, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. And so we do this, we help support school districts, school systems, charter, independent, private, by providing experiential learning workshop called Students Thrive that kind of unpacks five dimensions and really help people to begin talking about equity, school mm-hmm. equity, yeah. right? Then the second tool is the actual assessment, the comprehensive school culture climate equity assessment that we do in partnership with Bethune School Solutions, mm-hmm. Which is a comprehensive, when I say comprehensive, from parent, student, faculty and staff, kind of perception surveys, observations in the classroom, interviews with the leadership, focus groups with parents, students, mm-hmm. and staff. Mm-hmm. And then from that assessment.
And a desk audit. So
and a desk audit, yes, that's right.
Data, performance data, how are we serving various communities, gifted education, those with special needs, special
discipline.
Discipline, and looking at things like
right.
that.
Right, how do teachers get to teach, you know, special education gifted programs, like how are they connected and can, you know, teach the diversity of the faculty and staff. And then the third tool really connects the assessment tool to create a culturally responsive teaching and learnership academy to kind of provide some professional learning and some kind of co-community design to really address what comes out of the assessment. And so just want to share that that's a resource that we provide. Would love, you know, if folks are interested, if you're hearing this and are interested, definitely reach out to us to learn more. The reason why, one of the reasons why I'm really sharing this also is to begin to talk about, you know, and provide some thoughts around the preparation for the new school year, however it looks, right? Whether children are really fully back in a seat in a building, or if we're still in this online world, but just how to help teachers and, you know, leaders in the school environment get ready, right? Or and honest and be very honest about what is going to happen between now and when school starts back up. And I know one of the things that we talked about was, you know, we already know there is inequity in our system, in our school system. And for the our most marginalized, under-resourced, disinvested communities, this will intensify. And so, and I guess the first question is, so how do we know it will intensify, right? Like, how do we look out, or how will it intensify based on what we know?
I mean, you can, well, there's so many different ways that you can really think about this. But if you are thinking about students in a community where they've been found, or data shows that they're not reading on grade level, right? Okay. And so now we've come through, and teachers at the beginning of the year, schools at the beginning of the year have this data about students, and they set a plan, right? Okay, so here's the performance that they had on state testing, other testing that we had. Here's what we're doing going into next year. Here's how we prepare for this school year. So the 2019-2020 school year is this the pre-planning is setting up for this, like, we know our data, we know we want to go, we've collectively collaborated to figure out where the goals were, and we set out on this track. And this track isn't permanent, but it's being adjusted as we move, but it's this way to be able to make the gains and reach the goals that we had set. Well, right now, now we've come to this part where we're almost through the year, but March, that has just been cut off, right? And so this plan to help us move our students from point A to point D, right, is now interrupted. And so much so, we might not have a strong understanding of where that interruption occurred. Was it at point B, at point C? Where were they at in that? Now, schools regularly are taking formative data and summative data, you know, every 6 weeks, some school districts, every 10 weeks. So they do have that data, right? And they're able to say where students are at. But now what happens is we don't have the end, whatever, March, April, May, and then for some schools that are ending in June, that could be 4 months worth of learning that is lost, right?
And checking in on learning.
Uh-huh. And they're trying to create a system to help as best as possible keep students on that learning track, right? Working with teachers to create lesson plans to keep that. So now we're going to finish this year, right? If I'm thinking going into pre-planning next year, right, which for most educators would actually begin in May, you know, April, May, they're starting to think about what next year is going to look like. It's hard to really know what to expect next year, right? We know where they left off at, and I believe most school districts are going to advance children. So if our daughter's in kindergarten, as I guess as long as we complete the work and try our best to stay on that, she'll be in first grade. But that won't be an official first grade. She wouldn't have finished all that knowledge. So it's so now what we talk about is, like, if you have students that are, as we know, Black and brown children are experiencing an academic performance gap that is hard, and you said a resource gap. Well, now, if we're going into this next year and there's already this, what we call the opportunity gap, where the resources sit, that opportunity gap was already wide for many schools. Mm-hmm. Now we're gonna restart the year with that same opportunity gap, but now we know that their learning has been cut short,
right,
some 4 months, 6 months earlier than that. So we have to know that these inequities, that these gaps will in theory be intensified. We just have to know that that's gonna be.
Yeah.
And given that, and we know the way, so interesting, before we started this conversation, there was a quote that we were gonna use. But even thinking about in regards to the allocation and just thinking about the flow of dollars, federal, local, budgets and things like that, and given this current pandemic, fear, anxiety, there are already folks predicting that people are going to be very squeamish around how to close that gap with initiatives, mm-hmm. with things that honestly, that I know our leaders have thoughts about of like, how do we close that? Like, as you talk about opportunity gap and the government being much more tighter on the budgets and the purse strings. Mm-hmm. And so, which is going to, again, the money flow, right, into is inequitable already. Like the school closures, the way that there have been, studies and books to talk about the realities that even though we know like per pupil rates and things like that, but when you look at certain schools like here in Atlanta, it's a very big difference between the resources that are in North Atlanta school districts versus South Atlanta school districts, schools, I should say, mm-hmm. versus North Atlanta schools.
Well, and if we bring that down a little bit finer point, we can look at, while I don't have this data specific with me, but median income, for
yes.
households.
Yes.
And I think it's safe to say the higher the median income, the more robust you can be navigating challenging times like this, right? To where you might have access to continue to create online tutoring to be able to make up for that support when other communities with a lower median income, which we traditionally see here in the Atlanta area, south of I-20, right? That robustness, that ability to recover or navigate successfully those challenging, the kind of break in traditional schooling that we see are more challenging in those environments where that are facing socioeconomic challenges in that way.
But I think the whole way that we are thinking about supporting schools financially has to change drastically as we go into a new school year, given the this effect of the pandemic. Like we have to, like the current models that people are using and talking about, like we have to expand and be more creative of what does it look like to really center equity and have more of a human-centered approach socially, and knowing, what is happening in communities and invest in education that way.
Right. Well, we have to think about it like this, right? There's this common phrase that when America gets a cold, Black African Americans get the flu. Black people get the flu. That's a common saying that's out there. And what that's saying is that because of historical injustices and inequities that we've experienced, a point of challenge or struggle more exponentially impacts a community that has struggled to navigate equitable situations. And so when we think about this, what Natasha's saying is thinking creatively about how do we or how might we allocate funds to really be able to support schools that are in communities that have been under-resourced. right? Where a larger portion of students are being marginalized. Because if it is the same budget or the same stream that's coming in, or I don't necessarily say that it's like everybody getting an equal amount in their particular schools, but we have to understand the populations in which these schools are serving and think creatively about how the funds can really meet their needs, right? It's not a one-size-fits-all system. And I know that our school districts aren't a one-size-fits-all school district. They have a very extensive and detailed formula for that, but how might this formula be changed to now account for the challenges that are going to be faced moving into this next school year? So it's just it's encouraging people to think about that and know that, you know, this is where that creativity has to be there and wanting to start the conversation around, well, what will that take? Because if we start up trying to implement potentially the same system, we will then further exacerbate the inequities that are being experienced through funding allocation.
Right. And also just to add to that, just the reality, right, that I talked about in the previous video in terms of day two around Black people are disproportionately being represented as cases and deaths across the country. And also in the South, there are more Black young people that they are projecting that will get this virus. Mm-hmm. And so that means, you know, I can imagine that, you know, I'm already, you know, we've already seen just people impacted in our community, people that I've worked with, people that I'm literally friends, like we're conference friends, having relatives that have this virus or dying from this virus. So we also got to think about the mental health and stressors that the children are experiencing, as well as the teachers, faculty, and staff themselves, especially if they, you know, are from these communities, and how that is going to affect the learning environment and how the schools will really address and support that, because that also has to do with, am I ready to learn? Am I ready to receive?
Right. Right.
And also from a teacher perspective, am I ready to give? Like, this is, you
know. Well, I mean, there's a lot, you know. I was just thinking about with the restart, you know, this is not just for students. These are also for the educators that are leading in this environment, right? How does, from there's been this immediate move from in-person meetings to now virtual meetings, right? Mm-hmm. How do we reboot the culture? How do we, as a school leader, as an area district superintendent, or as a school leader in a particular building, right? How do we rebuild morale, right? Because we, and everybody was in this, just moved to this place of, boom, this is happening. We're going to learning that's happening at school, right? Schooling online, right? Not online, you know, or learning. It's learning online is how that's going to happen, right? That was immediate. That was a stressor, right? And so there has to be some intentional work about how do we support educators during this time, right? And that's principals, it's assistant principals, it's instructional coaches, all those other types of things, is being prepared to restart the professional culture that's within the building that will then lead the full school culture with the environments that's there.
Our virtual building, because we don't know.
Right. And how do you begin to prepare for that when you really don't, it's uncertain of what might happen? Now, we can all sit and say we believe this thing will pass, and we will re, you know, our school year will be back. But we can't 100% say that. And that also asks the challenge of, like, so now there's a lot of different contingency plans. So with district leaders, they're thinking about how do we best serve our students now? What might it even look like? So there has to be a think tank of thinking about what are these options, these alternatives that's going to happen. Because right now, like, what is the summer going to look like for students, right? If, you know, what might happen? We were talking offline or before we started, summer learning loss, right? We're just looking at many summer camps are canceling, right? So how are we going to care for kids in this space? And I was listening to this podcast that is just, this all seems to fall on schools and school districts. When it's a city issue, right? This is a city issue that's happening, and it has to be a collective city approach to be able to navigate this, because While I think schools are positioned to be able to support the communities in very unique and personalized, localized way, it's a city issue.
Right.
And those city issues, or a county issue, and to be able to put that all on a set of leaders for a school district, I think that there are highly qualified superintendents, building leaders who are intelligent enough and creative enough to tackle this, mm-hmm. but that's asking a lot.
Right, and it's so funny, I was just, one of our consultants, Drakita Overton, shout out tweet,
hey,
posted
Elizabeth City
information on Fulton County Health Department has closed, I think, 3 local health centers in Black communities, like that are Black, and also these communities are they're already under-resourced. So we're talking about during the pandemic, you're closing down a clear connection to health,
mm-hmm.
like health services that are closed. And we're talking about communities that don't, that a lot of them don't have access to the transportation.
Mm-hmm.
And so how are they going to get out, right? What if they, you know, and so again, this virus is adversely, disproportionately affecting Black people in our communities. And given that situation of thinking about, oh my God, there's 3 health centers in the community, and one of the health centers literally is not that far from a local school, right? And so what does that mean? And, you know, just thinking about was education at the table when these things were closed?
Mm-hmm.
Like, and thinking about the children that seek services there, their parents that seek services there, in connection to health.
And there's also educators that seek services there as well.
So exactly. That live in those communities. Right. It's a whole ecosystem. And so I guess just to kind of just think about what are some, I guess, some things that our leaders and teachers should be thinking about as they move through this process and really leaning to, you know, kind of the ebb and flow of this, mm-hmm. right? As political leaders are changing the scope of shelter in place of all of these things. Like, what are some things that, you know, currently right now for teachers going through this to kind of round out the end of the school year? And then mm-hmm. what should leaders be thinking about as they go?
Yeah, I mean, I think there's so many different levels, but I'll start on the heart level. I think it's important to understand that this is going to be a marathon and not a sprint. You know, I think John Lewis had a quote, don't be a candle, not a firecracker, right? So meaning we're not going to solve these issues overnight. And what we have to do, what's important is to know that it's the slow burn or the long run, right? And so thinking about how do we take, you know, one of our work is around healing and emotional self-care. How do we take care of ourselves in this time so that we can continue to do the best work possible, right? Not to continue to, mm-hmm. to push to get everything I need,
mm-hmm.
but it's the best work possible. So the question is, what does it mean? What does it look like or mean for it to be our best work in this time, right? Because I think it's mm-hmm. it's very challenging to try and recreate and expect things to go back to normal, right? Or to expect production levels to be the same mm. during this time. And so it's spending some time thinking about what does efficient work, what does productive look like in this season? And how do we make sure we peg it to a level, or we set it at a level that will allow us to navigate these uncertain times for a longer period of time,
mm-hmm.
right? So I said earlier at the beginning where it's like, for me, my emotion is calm and it's just slowing down because it, like, I have this need to, like, I got to be on every email, I got to be on every virtual call, I got to do this and this. Yes, those things are super important, but I know that, and we've talked about this, the days are getting longer, right? And as much as we want to be able to support, there has to be some self-compassion in there and knowing that not everything might be accomplished. And that also we're saying that there's so many things that are out of our control, but what we can do is set a goal for the day and do our best in trying to meet it so that we can meet those needs. So I think that's something that schools should be, I encourage all of us to be thinking about mm-hmm. and understanding and knowing that one as a parent side is patience, right, with that. But then as on the educational side is really just saying, well, what's going to be our new objectives? How do we make space? Are we listening to our teachers? So many great mm-hmm. principals out there say the best way to navigate and to lead a school is to listen to your teachers. Are we creating frameworks to listen to not just our teachers, but it's also the support staff that are in the building? Is there a mechanism to listen to the principal? Because mm-hmm. principals find themselves to be very isolated mm-hmm. during these times, right? Because some of them are making very set decisions because the timing just has to go and they're being mm-hmm. dictated to. And so who's caring for them, right? So it's really this emotional self-care side of things that I think is really important. Now, there's so many other things to discuss and spend time on in terms of budget, in terms of resources, in terms of what the learning is going to look like.
Human capital, like all of that.
Like hiring. There's a lot of different aspects, of this. Is it, with districts that are facing teacher shortages, mm-hmm. will this exacerbate that even more? Might it mm-hmm. help it? It's really beginning to think like that. But in this time of great stress, we have to find some time to keep ourselves whole and calm. And we're seeing a lot of people doing starting meditation or continuing their meditation practice, right? Or you can just say deep breathing. Some people say yoga. I just say stretching, going out there for a walk, staying connected in various communities, in that way. And so I think it's just taking our time and knowing that we don't know what the outcome is. And it is okay not to know, right? and it is okay to actually work with someone who thinks they know. Because I think many leaders have to communicate this idea that I know what's gonna happen. But we as followers also have to say, yes, I understand that. But not put all my eggs in the basket of this is where it's gonna go. It's really being open and responsive and what we call in the present moment so that we can be our best selves for the moment that arises.
All right. That sounds great.
Sorry, I just...
Yeah, I mean...
talking a lot, streaming a lot.
Yeah.
But that's why we have, we have our online series of Get Out the Fire, which actually is helping. We believe it is an emotional self-care practice, which basically teaches you about stress, fight, flight, and freeze, and how our body is responding to that. Because as we felt that with communicating this knowledge and giving information about what our body is doing through these traumatic, stressful times, we then have the power and potentially some tools to be able to navigate it and become mm-hmm. more aware of it as we move through this. So we do have yes. that as well. And that's offered on our website as well at CommunityBuild Ventures, Get Out the Fire is that particular work. So giving those emotional self-care strategies are definitely important. Mm-hmm. But then also, we talked about, and we're going to wrap this, but, as you see on the screen, the equity-centered school improvement, what we also do is help frame conversations about our job is not to tell you what your school environment needs. Our job is to come in and have a framework for discussion and guidance and facilitation to get you to identify what your needs, what needs are you currently serving? What are the new needs you would like to go? And what's your bigger vision for the culture and the experience for students, faculty, staff, and community as they engage in this learning environment? So that's what we offer.
Sure. All right. Thank you, Aida. Yes. And so we would love to kind of hear your thoughts around education. Even just talking about your experience right now as a parent, as a teacher, as a school leader, as a community member of, a concerned community member in regards to education, about the schools in your community. So definitely share in the comment box.
And also as an education consultant, what are you thinking with the area in which you focus and concentrate? What are you thinking about? What are you trying to create? We want to be able to hear from you, those ideas that are germinating with you as a current need you see, or as a need that's coming on the horizon.
Sure. And so as usual, what I've been doing for the past 2 days is really call to action. So the first thing is, if you're a Black social change leader in the South, we really want your feedback. CommunityBuild Ventures, we're seeking to center and transform the lived experiences of Black people leading racial equity and justice in the South. And the South, we are including Louisiana, you know, all the way up to West Virginia, Kentucky, and of course, we're including Florida. A lot of people exclude Florida as if they're not, it is the South.
They didn't let Black folks on beaches down there either. Anyway, I'm sorry.
Yes, that's another conversation, and that is real. And the reason why Mary McLeod Bethune, God rest her soul, actually bought her and other Black business owners actually bought land, but I digress. But yes, Florida is a part of it. But we really want to hear from you to really share your experiences in accessing healing and self-care services, as well as services that you want to access that just really help your work that you're doing in the South. So we want to hear from you. After you take the survey, we will provide you free access to the resource I daily share, Get Out the Fire, which is a workbook, breathing exercise, and videos that help you, you know, transmute, move beyond feeling overwhelmed, overworked, and over it.
Right.
And so again, here is, let me just click on here so you can kind of see where this is, A New Way to Thrive. So this is the link to it. Mm-hmm. Please check it out, take the survey, share it with your community of other practitioners. Mm-hmm. And again, when we say Black, we're talking about all the Black people that are part of the African diaspora, from Caribbean, Afro-Latinx folks, you know, our Afro South American brothers and sisters. We're talking about all of those folks that are working and doing racial equity and justice in the South. Yeah.
And I would say that what's also important to know is that also for if you hope to engage in more emotional self-care practices, and you know that that's something that you want, we also want to hear from you. So it's not always just say, we just want to understand and know and collect your voice and your lived experience in this space.
Right. Absolutely. The results of the survey, we're also doing focus groups. So definitely in the comment box, if you're interested in participating in the focus group, please let us know. We can send you that information as well. What we hope to really is just to understand the resources that are there and how CommunityBuild Ventures can also be a continuum of that, continue that work and support all Black social justice leaders in the South. All right, and again, our friends at the Black Emotional Mental Health Collective, again, I've been sharing these resources, helplines around mental health. You can pause the video right now so they can, you can jot down these numbers. Please share it with your community, with your network, with friends and family. We understand, is a traumatic experience. And so here are some resources to help you move through this experience the best that we can, right? Mm-hmm. And then the last thing is, so the last video I shared that the COVID, like this whole COVID-19 resource is overload, like completely overload. And so I've been mining like all of these resources that I've been receiving. And here are my top picks. If you go to our to this link here that's at the top, you will get these, again, short resources if you're in philanthropy, right? Mm-hmm. You are a grant maker. If you're a nonprofit and small business, look at that. One link.
that we found so far.
No. Oh. One link.
Oh, this one link that you coordinated.
Yes. Is a comprehensive searchable database of everything you can think about. So all these things that people are talking about, even in your city. So even when I looked at Atlanta, like the resource that I was going to share, I'm like, it's already there. It already is connected. So again, one resource. Individuals, here are some resources for you. And I want to just, this one right here gives information for parents and students. Mm-hmm. So it's great. Love this resource. And when I say all these resources that I'm sharing, they are updating them like literally every hour.
Right.
So it's all there. How to file an unemployment claim, COVID-19 mutual aid, you're an individual and you need to get connected, like with money for utilities, with money, whatever that is. Here is a huge national listing of mutual aid groups all across the country. So again, it's all here. I've mined it and narrowed it down to the sites that are the most promising, that has everything there, so that you aren't taking link by link and trying to figure out, is this for me, mm-hmm. right? Or is this for my organization? So it's all here. So I'm you know, thankful. Again, I've been mining this. I've been receiving resources since the second week of March. And I, you know, again, it's been overload, but I would say these are the best of the best that really act as clearing houses and information for you so that you aren't trying to piecemeal it yourself. All right. Well, that's all we got for today.
Well, thank you.
Thank you so much for your daily. It's been a pleasure. And so again, I will be back on Friday with our final conversation. And that conversation right now is just talking about our ancestors and death during this time, as we all are hearing stories of death and then how to have ceremony and celebrate life and to think through that. So that's our conversation on Friday. Have a great day. And remember, drink a lot of water.
That's what was in this cup.
Drink a lot of water. Rest often.
Pace yourself.
Please pace yourself. And get some exercise. Have a great day. Bye.